Greetings, BakoToons listeners. This is Matt, back with an amazing episode number 40 of the BakoToons podcast. Since we reached the big 4-0, I decided to have a very special guest on the show. All the way from Long Beach, California, Brian Coakley, lead guitar and vocalist of one of the best live bands around, Wax Apples. Many of you may not realize that Brian Coakley is also a member of one of my all-time favorite bands, the Cadillac Tramps from Orange County. Back in the day, the Tramps used to travel up to Baco and play at the Mask downtown. The Mask was owned by a member of the original Baco punk rock scene, Jimmy Green. The Mask went through a few changes, but now it stands as a storefront for rent. Boo-hoo. Brian, along with his lovely wife Jamie, now have the Wax Apples belting out a combination of original OC punk coming from bands like Social Distortion. Of course, the Cadillac Tramp vibes is there, but with Wax Apples, there's something brand new brought to the table. Brian opens up a lot about how much the OC music scene has changed, even mentioning our homeboys Korn, who relocated their post-Seattle grunge. There's also a big Wax Apples connection to Bakersfield's The Dives that are playing right now as we speak, so pay attention. This is a really great interview and a lesson for all of you musicians out there. Here's part one of my special two-part interview with Brian Coakley of Wax Apples here on episode 40 of the BakoToons podcast. This is Matt with the BakoToons podcast on Bakotopia.com. I'm on the phone with a member of one of Long Beach and the OC's hottest bands right now, the Wax Apples. Can you please state your name and what instrument do you play, sir?
Brian Coakley. I play guitar and sing.
Okay, now, originally I was planning on interviewing you and your wife, Jamie, who's also a member of the band. Who else is missing from this interview?
That would be James Grissom, our drummer, and Marcus Irvin, our bass player.
I want to get some history about the Wax Apples.
I guess a brief history of the band would be we kind of formed out of the ashes of I was on a major label for a while. I was in the Cadillac Tramps for a really long time, and the Cadillac Tramps broke up for a little while. After the band broke up, I got on a major label with my band Rule 62. That label deal kind of went sour. It was with Madonna's label.
Maverick.
We put out a record, and it just kind of got a bad taste in our mouth about the whole major label scene. And so at the end of that, I was left with just myself. Basically, I kind of disbanded the band. Rule 62 was the band, and I didn't really know what I wanted to do or where, what direction I was going to go in, but I knew that I loved music, and so I basically recorded a bunch of songs. And I really felt like not a lot of the music that was out right now, or at the time, actually, it was about 5 years ago, 6 years ago, and I really just felt like the music was flat. Like, there wasn't really any cool music that I thought was, like, the kind of music that should be played. So I sort of, at the time, didn't realize it, but I was creating a genre, in a sense, because there wasn't really any other bands around here that was doing what I was trying to do, which was taking a combination of all the stuff that I grew up with, as far as, you know, like 70s classic rock that I got from my older brothers and sisters, to my punk rock roots, which was my youth, my anthems and my music was the Sex Pistols and the Clash and the, you know, the Ramones before that, Iggy Pop. And then later when I started getting into blues and more like rhythm and blues and like soul and you know, James Brown and everything from basically Little Richard all the way through to like the Sex Pistols and everything in between. And I wanted to combine those elements of rock and roll into something that was cohesive and didn't sound like, so many times when people love too many different kinds of music, their bands can kind of sound like a bunch of different, like they're all over the place. And I instead wanted to kind of create a genre. So I recorded some stuff based on my love of all those different kinds of music of the past, and also my love of kind of like what Beck was doing with a lot of cut and paste mixed in with blues and country. And stuff like John Spencer Blues Explosion and R.L. Burnside and just a bunch of different, there was a bunch of different stuff that was current and cool and new that I really liked from a lot of scenes, but I just didn't think anybody was putting it together the way I wanted to hear it, you know?
That's a pretty broad range of music that you're talking about right here.
It is. It's funny. It is. But then the funny thing is like, I was just talking about it with my friend the other day, is like that, you know that movie School of Rock?
Yeah.
Have you ever seen the movie School of Rock?
Oh, yes, yes.
Teaching the kids, and he's got the chalkboard, and he's like, you know, it comes from like the New York Dolls to the Clash to this to that.
The family tree, kind
of. The family tree of rock, and you can walk that family tree of rock back, and actually you can find the common ground all the way through. And there's guys that put it together, like Beck's last record, the last one he just put out.
Weddle.
It's amazing. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's amazing. I love that record. I mean, I just can't listen to it enough because I see what he's doing or what he's trying to do, at least to me. And it's putting together rock and roll with like a dance and a hip-hop kind of flavor in it. But yet, it's not really like urban music in a sense. It's like white urban rock and roll disco or something. You know, he kind of combines all these things, but then when you hear it, it just sounds like Beck.
Yeah.
But you don't get this thing like it's a bastardized genre. It's like he just created his own. And so I was trying to go for a sound that was just my sound and being another branch of rock and roll on that family tree, but not turning away from anything that I'd learned along the way, encompassing the better parts, you know? You know, there's that take what you want and leave the rest behind. So I would just take, like, for me, there's something about a crunchy Marshall guitar that I don't think I'll ever get away from.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the sound of a Gibson Les Paul through a Marshall, just, I love it. It just makes me happy. So even if, no matter what kind of music I'm playing, there's going to be that in there. And I really love the fat that they get from, like, some of the dance music and like hip hop and stuff. I just love the fatness of the electronic drums, but I also like the lo-fi too, so I like to combine those things. So in Wax Apples, we've kind of combined blues, country, rock and roll, and then we have loops and such in there fattening things up. They're not always right up front, and it doesn't always drive the whole song, but it's in there giving it flavor like salt and pepper, you know?
Yeah, thickens the sound, more of like a almost like a Phil Spector type of effect.
Sort of, in a way, you know? Like a wall of sound that's still got holes, you know?
And what year did you guys actually officially become the Wax Apples?
Oh, shoot. That would have been, dang, it's hard to say. We came up with the name about 6 years ago, and we were just kind of, I recorded the original music, I recorded all myself.
Mm-hmm.
And played all the instruments, and it was pretty complex and had a lot of different instrumentation. I just kind of played everything on it. And so I kind of worked it backwards. I recorded everything and then put a band together. And, you know, we started out with a 7-piece band.
Really?
Trying to recreate all the nuances that I had put into that recording. And then what happened was, is over time, I just realized the headaches involved in that. And I stripped down and stripped down and stripped down. And so we, from playing it out live, we actually evolved into what we are now, which is a lot more of a rock band.
Mm-hmm.
Even though we still incorporate all those things, I learned that, you know, you can do everything you want in the studio, but if you can't put it out like what you're doing in the studio, if you can't take that to the streets, more or less, you can't put it out live, then you don't got much to go on because people are always disappointed. Like, they'll hear the music and they'll go, this is so great, and then they come see you and it's like, what was that?
What about the band's name? What, is there a story behind the band's name?
There actually is, because we wanted to pick a name that kind of encompassed what we were doing and where and what we were about. And the original music that we did was on a Power Mac, an older, like a Macintosh computer. And it was a, you know, I think it was a G4 or something, but basically the Macintosh platform being, you know, in the old days they used to say when they were cutting a record, they would say they were putting it to wax, and it was actually a wax acetate that you could play it, you know, the original ones were like, you could only play them like 10 times or something, and then they were shot, and they were actually made out of wax, and so that's what they used to say they were putting it to wax, and that stayed the slang for recording even into the record, the vinyl record era, and now it's still kind of the slang even in the CD era. So what we were, our wax was actually an Apple, so because our actual disc that we cut to was an Apple hard drive, so it was like the wax was an Apple, and so we put it to wax, and we ended up with the Wax Apples.
That's a cool story right there. You know, there's a lot of bands that can't, you know, when you ask them about their band's name, most of them just say, oh, it was just kind of like a funny name we just kind of found. But I'm glad somebody finally has like a really cool story to tell about that. I can appreciate it.
Somebody be like, oh, yeah, I don't know. It sounded cool.
Yeah. Now, was it always a part of the concept to have, of course, your wife, Jamie, to front the band, so to speak? You know, I mean, you guys both sing the leads together, kind of like John Doe and X in a way, but did she start out in the band?
She came in before there was even a band. because what we were doing was when another thing we were doing when we cut the record was we were trying to the first music that we first did. We were very we did it outside the studio system, I guess, which is a way to say we did it basically at our house. And we had just moved into this house in Long Beach that had a nice picture window, and you could look out into the nice green backyard, and it was all nice and cozy. And we moved into the living room there and kind of made the living room our recording studio. And I was working with a producer named Chris Furman. And he had done a bunch of work with Brian Eno and Daniel Lanois and all these guys that were really big on doesn't matter the acoustics of the room or any of that. It's more about the vibe. So when we were laying it down, you know, we would just say, hey, Jamie, you want to sing backups on this? Hey, Jamie, you want to sing backups on this? Sing some backups on this. And one thing led to another where she had sung on most of the stuff. And when it came time to form the band, it was like, well, what am I going to go find a chick to sing backups or just have Jamie do it, you know? And the whole concept behind our band became this thing where it was like, we want to be family-oriented. We want to be very inclusive with all the people that, like our drummer's wife, our bass player's wife, anybody who has anything to do with it, like we would try to exist more like a kind of a tribe, where you know everybody, not just the warriors or the or get to go on tour. You know, it's like everybody can go if somebody wants to go and they're feeling left out or they feel like their boyfriend or their husband's gone too long, then bring them along, you know, and kids are welcome and all that kind of stuff. We try to be this all-inclusive thing where everybody feels like they're welcome and allowed, and if they want to come down when we're recording, they can sit in the room. Nobody's going to freak out, like, what are they here for, you know? Or it's very, like, anti-prima donna, anti-rock star attitude, you know?
Yeah, so that obviously helps. You know, how has that affected your marriage? Has it obviously been a positive thing for your marriage, you know, to be able to have you know, you're playing alongside your wife. You know, you know, you read the rock and roll kind of horror stories about stuff happening like that, but you've kind of developed like a concept that actually seems to be working. You know, how does it you know, how would you describe it to somebody like me who I've been playing music all my life, and you know, my girlfriend doesn't play in the band, but I look at him like, wow, you know, I just, all these thoughts go through my head. I wonder if it's easy, you know.
Well, I mean, you know what I mean, at the end of the day, you gotta have, you're with that person all the time. I mean, we have a son, we have a house, we have you know, the record label, which is a lot of work, and Jamie basically runs the record label, Nadine Records, which existed just to put out our record. And
where does the name Nadine Records come from?
Well, Nadine was my my aunt, my mother's sister, and she was I had a long struggle with drugs, and when I was at the core of being at the bottom of my strung out times, Nadine was like the one person in my life that still gave me unconditional love, even after, like, you know, my parents had long kicked me out long ago, and everyone in my family was kind of like, yeah, don't let him come over, he'll try to steal something from you. And, you know, people were just kind of at that point where they're kind of over it. She was the one person that never turned her back on me and never gave up on me. And she, 2 years ago, died of breast cancer, and she struggled. And, you know, I was actually, since I'd gotten my shit together and all that, since that time, and at the, you know, so when she was going through her worst time of her chemo and all that, I got to have to be there. I had to be there, but I also got to be there for her. And so it's just kind of like a tribute, you know. It's
That's really beautiful,
a tribute,
man.
A tribute to, you know, one of my favorite people that ever lived in the world, and was, you know, she'd be one of those people, because it's hard, man. You know, when you play music, so you know, you can do everything right and still not succeed.
Yeah.
It's possible to do that. Like, there's not that many other businesses in the world where you could say, I went out and I did everything right, and I still didn't succeed. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And basically, the flavor of the month took over, and I was out. And, you know, there's just a million things that can happen, and then it's a creative thing, and it's people's taste and all these other things and come into it. So she'd be the one person that, you know, when think chips were down, just out of the blue, you'd get this card in the mail, I believe in you, keep, you know, keep going, keep trying, and blah, blah, blah. So when it came time for us to do the label, it was just, that was, we decided to name it after her.
That's beautiful, man. That's definitely beautiful. I'm listening to your first CD, The Wax Apples, the self-titled. Uh-huh. I hear the strong, like really classic OC feel, 80s punk mixed with some 50s rock and roll. There was also the added element with the tenor saxophone, you know. Uh-huh. You know, and that's what I hear. But do you still have this tenor sax playing in the band?
Actually, we just parted ways with him.
Wow.
He's not in the band anymore. We recorded with him on our new record.
Mm-hmm.
The new record's got the sax in it, but we just, you know, it was one of those things where it come to a point, you know, band members, inner group play and
mm-hmm.
inner whatever you want to call it, and it was just time to move our separate ways.
Mm-hmm.
And we're kind of debating whether we're going to replace it or not. We've done shows with another guy playing instead of him,
yeah.
a guy named Jeff from the band Funhole, and that's gone well, and then we've played shows with just as a four-piece, and there's something kind of cool about just being a four-piece, too.
Yeah.
You know, I actually was the one who came up with the idea of putting in the sax in the first place, and everybody kind of looked at me like I was crazy, and I'm like, well, you don't get it. I mean, it's going to be cool. It's going to be, like, surfy more. You know, I was thinking more surf, like that nasty sax that's, like, mm-hmm. in like, you know.
Growling sound, because that's the way I hear the tone in the saxophone, because I'm a sax player, so I hear that it's really growling. And I see how you guys have incorporated in there, so I dig it, you know.
Yeah, I always was thinking of it almost more of as another guitar part.
Mm-hmm.
And that kind of is what happened, is I had recorded the music first, and I had recorded, like, you know, two different guitar parts on almost all the songs. So then when we re-recorded them with the sax, a lot of the times the tags he was playing were actually the guitar parts that I had played. So he was just mimicking the guitar on the sax with that growly kind of buzzsaw sound
mm-hmm.
that those tenor saxes can get, which I love.
Yo, stay tuned for the second part of my two-part interview with Brian Coakley of Wax Apples here on episode 40 of the Baco Tunes podcast, brought to you by, of course, Bacotopia.com. Hello, kiddies. Here's part two of my two-part Baco Tunes episode 40 interview with Brian Coakley of Wax Apples. In this segment, Brian talks about all kinds of interesting stuff, the new OC scene and his connection to Bakersfield's The Dives, or just a little bit. So check it out. Here we go.
Whose idea was it to cover the Cadillac Tramp song Shake on the first CD? Was that your idea?
I think that actually, I don't remember who really wanted to do it. I think our drummer, James, actually was the one who, because, you know, I had just given him a Tramp CD, and he was kind of messing around playing all the stuff, and he was... Mm-hmm. talking about how he really liked Spanky's drumming, and he was, he just kept talking, like, we should do a cover of Shake, you know, he just kept kind of bringing it up, and mm-hmm. when we messed around with it at practice, it just really sounded good, and it sounded good because I really like the way Matt, the sax player, put in the baritone sax, where it's got the berry in there, and it's mm-hmm. going, bop, 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 you know, it just kind of gave it more of a, I don't know what the feel it was. What the word is I'm thinking about, but it just had a good.
It just has a really, like, a lot of good color to the song. You know, it's already a great song, man. I've had, you know, Tombstone Radio when it first came out, so I was like, I always always play that song. So when I actually heard you guys on Indie 103.1 when I was living in L.A. I was living over there, and then Dickie Barrett used to play it all the time. When my band, I have, like, a ska band here. We've been playing here for years, and we did the ska class reunion of the El Rey, and when he had me and some of the other band members on his show, I said, hey, how can I get a copy of that Wax Apples that did Shake? And so he's the one who gave me your CD.
Oh, wow. That's cool.
that was like that strange connection right now. It was like one of the last things I did. We took a picture, and I said, hey, how can I get one of those Wax Apples CDs? He goes, hold on, I'll be right back. He ran into his office, and he came back and gave it to me, so I still have that same copy.
Well, that's cool, man.
Yeah, man. So
he was a great supporter. In fact, when all that funkiness went down with 103.1 and him
mm-hmm.
and all that, we completely cut ties with 103.1. We just, like, said, okay, you know what, friendship's thicker than whatever, you know. And
yeah,
that's kind of the way we roll. So we just,
yeah, you guys were doing you know, your daily on the scene,
that Places We Like to Go.
Yeah, Places We Like to Go with Brian and Jamie Wax Apples. I really used to play it all the time.
We had fun doing that. It was fun. It was a lot of work, though, man. I was producing all those episodes at my house, and it was
mm-hmm.
geez, man, one more thing for me to do. But I mean, it was really fun, and the company that was sponsoring it, Blue Sea, they really didn't want us to stop doing it. We called them right when we heard the whole Dickie thing went down, and it was like, you know what, we're gonna have to pull our show. We can't do it if Dickie's getting jerked like that. And they were like, no, it's just business. And it's like, no, you know what, we started our own indie label because we wanted to not have to kiss any butt. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
so
exactly.
It's like we're not going to kiss any butt. We're just if we don't think something's right, we're not going to do it, and that's it.
Yeah, well, your heart's in the right places, of course. Yeah, that was a real big disappointment, because that was a thing to look forward to every morning, was to listen to Dickie's show in the morning when I was doing the commute from Venice to Hollywood to work. So.
Oh yeah, man, I used to
love it. Was a drag.
Yeah, and if you get to meet him and stuff, and you know, it's like then you're right there in the booth with them. When you're driving in the car, you're like,
yeah.
Oh, I was there 2 days ago.
Yeah, I used to win all kinds of contests and all that stuff, so I was totally addicted to that. So it was a big disappointment. Do you still play with Cadillac Tramps at all when they do their reunion shows?
Yeah. In fact, the funny thing is like in 99, we got back together, and we've been back together ever since.
Okay, then I went to Alex's bar in Long Beach. Mm-hmm. When you guys played the night before the big Katrina benefit over there at the House of Blues?
Oh, was it that big? Was it the rainy night? Was it raining?
No, I don't know if it was raining, but I remember you guys were playing. It was you guys in Throw Rag, I think, and it was at Alex's. And then the next day or the next couple days later, it was like an all day Hurricane Katrina benefit, and it was at the House of Blues in Anaheim.
Right.
Yeah. So that was the last time I saw you guys. But I remember.
Yeah, the thing with the Tramps is that we're all doing other stuff,
mm-hmm.
and we kind of have it in perspective. We're still the Cadillac Tramps. We still play shows. In fact, we have some shows coming up in January that are going to be really cool. It's going to be the Suicide Girls, the Cadillac Tramps, and Reverend Horton Heat.
Oh man, that's awesome!
It's going to be like five shows in a row, all in the LA area.
Oh, that's great, Matt. No, I've been seeing Tramps since back in the day when they were coming here, like to Bakersfield, all the time. Even when
we used to call those the cockfight tours.
Yeah.
Whenever we'd go to Bakersfield, we'd be like, "Woo! It's the Bakersfield cockfight tour."
Yeah.
we used to play that place, The Mask.
Oh yeah, yeah. Oh my God. So man, you've been with them that long, Jesus.
Yeah. That was like. Those were some of our first out-of-town shows, almost. And I remember the first night we went and played The Mask. We played there two nights in a row one time. And we played there the first night, and like it was just like nobody even cared. Everybody was like, who are these guys?
Uh-huh.
So we were like, what are we going to do? And we went to thrift stores, and we got like dresses and all these funky clothes. Like, I dressed up like a rodeo clown, and Gabby and Warren had dresses on. They were, like, lifting up each other's dresses, and we played the show like that. We're like, if they didn't care last night, man, they're going to trip out tonight.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah, because I was, like, wondering who's in the band and who's kind of, like, come in and out of the band. So I was confused. So, no, I've obviously seen you back then, because I've been to a bunch of shows, man. I got to see the CDs signed, and you probably signed my CD, and I just haven't looked at it close enough.
Yeah. Well, if you look at all the CDs, if you ever look at the artwork or anything on the mm-hmm. CDs, I'm Coakley. I wrote most of the songs, and I've been in the band the whole time.
Oh, shoot, man. Wow, shoot. This could be like a completely different direction, man. You know, speaking of the Cadillac Tramps and the whole kind of the OC scene that's kind of like sprouted off of theirs. It's kind of like the OC scene is kind of a little bit incestuous, isn't it? Like a lot of the bands, like you guys play in a variety of different bands together, kind of just mix and match. Is that kind of what goes down?
Sort of. I mean, the scene, I mean, it's weird because I don't even think that there's really an OC scene anymore. There's like the older statesman scene, like the guys that have been around forever, and they all kind of mix and mingle. Like, I know Gabby does, you know, he does Manic Hispanic. Mm-hmm. He does that band Flock of Goo Goo, which is like a really funny 80s band. And then of course, he has his band Drive-By Smile.
Yeah.
And then the Cadillac Tramps, and he does all that. And that's a lot of stuff. And then, like, that's got, like, Steve Soto, who's in the Adolescents, and that, mm-hmm. and he's in two of those other ones. And they all, yeah, it all mixes up. Everybody mixes up. And
okay, so you're talking about the
the younger scene, mm-hmm. the younger OC scene. You know, I don't know if it's younger, but the scene that's kind of cooking right now. I mean, I don't know what to say about it. I think that kind of Orange County has lost something in the respect of its individual sound.
Uh-huh.
And I don't think that we only had like one sound. I think we had like. Due to, you know, because of, like, Social Distortion,
yeah,
mostly. Social Distortion, there was always been a big punk force. in OC, right? I mean, OC has been big, a punk haven forever. So, and that, a lot of that's because of bands like, you know, TSOL, The Adolescents, you name it, D.I., just all those bitching classic punk bands, The Crowd, everybody that came out of OC that was really cool. And then what happened, I think, is that the Roots thing kind of spurned because Mike Ness took a decided turn towards more like a rootsy kind of rock and roll kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And that was awesome, too. But I just think now it's kind of weird because a lot of the OC bands that I see are kind of trying to be, they're all on this kind of Hollywood haircut trip that I call the Hollywood haircut thing, man. It's like they all want to be the Stooges.
Mm-hmm.
Or the Dead Boys or something, and they all have, like, Hollywood haircuts, and it's just like, that's not really, to me, the OC scene. I mean, there's still a kind of greaser thing, which is like a, where you got this, like, what is it, a punk rocker who went through a rockabilly fashion show or something.
Yeah, yeah, we'd always joke about that. I said, look, like, all the skinheads or the Rude Boys or something, they'd always just... They eventually became rockabilly at one point.
Yeah. And there was a big ska thing in Orange County for a while,
yeah.
You know, and that was kind of cool, too. That was a neat little side turn. And I just think now there's not really such an OC flavor anymore. I think it's kind of gotten homogenized like everything else. I mean, territorially, the whole thing with MTV and VH1 and all that crap, and you just, like, end up, everybody kind of sounds the same. And
absolutely.
Everybody's trying to be the Strokes, or everybody's trying to be what's kind of cool on the big screen now instead of what's cool in your local neighborhoods. I know, like, when we tour and stuff, or, you know, bands like the ones that I like to do shows with as far as with Wax Apples and stuff is, like, the bands that do have their own flavor. Because we're totally a band that has our own flavor. I mean, as far as, like, an OC sound, Wax Apples, we stick out like a sore thumb. Because we don't really look like the other bands, and we don't really sound like the other bands. We totally stand out, and it's usually for the better.
Do you feel like you're bringing the band back to, like, what OC is really about? You feel like you're bringing it back on there, you know? I mean, everything from the sound, the combining of the sound, to, you know, like, the stage, the kind of look that you guys are portraying, you know?
I'm definitely trying to bring it back to a more style-oriented time, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Wax Apples is trying to capture a little bit of more of a style, or a more of an individuality, you know what I mean? Because to me, instead of that, because that's kind of OC used to be more of a place where you'd have a Cadillac Tramps and a Social Distortion and a No Doubt,
yeah,
all at the same time.
Linda's Doll Hut.
And we would all play shows together.
Mm-hmm.
And nobody batted an eye. No one was like, oh, that's not right to go with that. You know, I mean, and then, it kind of started with bands like Korn and stuff like that kind of coming from other places. Because those guys that started out as LAPD, and they were all from Bakersfield, right?
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
And they came to, like, Orange County. And that was, like, the first thing where the guys that were all from Orange County were like, why the hell would you want to come to Orange County to try to make it? It's like, we live here, man, and all that.
Yeah.
But, you know, it just worked, whatever worked, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, at that one point, there was, like, Korn and Offspring and No Doubt and freaking everybody was just, like, seemed like them lit and all, you know, it seemed like everybody in OC was making it huge, you know.
Yeah. Hey, so the band's coming to Bakersfield to do a show with some of your friends, the Dives. This is, this obviously be your first time in Bakersfield with Wax Apples. What's your connection to the Dives?
My connection to the Dives is that that when I was on Maverick, my band Rule 62, that when the Cadillac Tramps actually broke up for a brief time in 94, we broke up. And in about 96... I got a record deal with my band Rule 62 on Maverick Records, Madonna's label.
Mm-hmm.
And John Goodell is the singer of the Dives, and he was the guitar player in Rule 62. So we've been friends for a long time. We've been bandmates and friends, and we've stayed friends. And it was funny because he was a lead singer guy.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he was like a front man, you know. He was a super good singer and a super good guitar player, and he wanted to back me up, and I was like, dude, you're like a front man guy. What are you doing, you know? But he liked what I was doing, and he thought, like, it was more like, I'm going to play for you for a while and kind of learn the ropes. And, you know, so it wasn't so much like I was his mentor. It was just like he kind of needed to learn how to be a band leader a little more and how to be the leader guy, you know. So he was in the band with us. But, I mean, he was always probably better than me anyway on guitar, better than me on singing, everything. It was funny, you know. It's like, dude, you're so talented. What are you doing? Then when the band broke up, you know, he started his own thing, but he also, in the meantime, moved to Bakersfield.
The buzz is going on around them right now, and this is going to be a great show, man. I can't wait. When I found out you guys were finally coming to Bakersfield, this is because once I moved back to Bakersfield, I was missing out on everything. But as far as I was able to hear you guys was just on the CD or on, you know, listening to like Indie 103 through the internet. Mm-hmm. So it's finally cool to be able to, you know, like I live like two blocks away now, man. So this is going to be a great show. I want to pump it up for you guys right here on Bakeltopia.com. Let everybody know.
Do you have a copy of the new album?
No, see, I don't. This is the only...
Oh, shoot, man.
Next Friday, September 29th at Sandrini's. It's free to get in, so everybody out there listening, there's no excuse. You better get out here and see this great band from Long Beach. Welcome them with open arms back over here. You know, the connection with the Cadillac Tramps and the Dives. And we're going to play a song off the new CD, and this is Barflies off of the new Wax Apple CD. So you better go out and buy it. Find out more about Wax Apples and the CD, where can they find the band?
They can go to waxapples.com, or they can go to the Wax Apples MySpace page, or both. They can get any of our music on iTunes, Napster, or right from our website. We actually have a store on our website, and you can do 49-cent downloads.
That's great. Now, see, that's a great value right there, listeners, so do it. And we wish Jamie a speedy recovery. I know she's kind of worn out right now, but you're going to dig this band. I can't wait to see him live, and I'm going to see everybody there. Thank you so much, Ryan, for being on the show.
Hey, no problem. Thank you.
All right, locos and locates, did you take notes? If you didn't, go back and listen again. Thank you, Brian Coakley of Wax Apples, for sharing your knowledge on this episode 40 of the Baco Tunes podcast. Can you believe it? We made it to 40 episodes. And to all the listeners out there, muchas gracias for listening. Peace. Bakotopia.com. Poor man who presides over me. Ow!
Don't forget to tune in next week for another exciting episode of Baco Tunes Radio, brought to you by Bacotopia.com. Peace.
Now go away or I shall taunt you a second time.